So the Ultimate Collection is your comeback to the music business with your greatest hits and a couple of new songs. What does it represent for you? Is it a new beginning for your great career?
You know, I feel that every moment in life, different things, it's okay to highlight and reflect. And I think for me, coming back with Sony, being reunited with an amazing record company, we felt it was the best entrance back to working together, to respect what we've done in our career. And then even when I walked away and went to a different record company, not because I didn't care, because of loyalty, I then come back and they wanted to share other songs that I had done outside of working with them, and even new songs that people may not have known I was part of, like Chicago soundtrack. And it was a moment for us to reflect and allow the audience to make it go back to the voice, because the voice is what I think a lot of music is missing in music.
Okay. What are your future plans in terms of studio recordings and live performances?
I have the Ultimate Collection tour already on sale, and the tour itself will be the actual album played live, so they get every song they want. If they want to hear those songs, they know exactly what the set list is. And then I'll share other songs with them, and I'll allow the audience to choose that via the internet. So we'll put the songs on the screen, and the audience that night will pick the song. I want to bring people up on one of my songs, so I'm just going to bring any fan up and sing songs with me. I want it to be about the fans, and I want my career to, because there's so much that I can thank them for, but to give them a tour that is really just their tour, you know? It's what songs they made famous, not me. I just put a crazy song out and they're like, yeah, you know? So I'm really respecting them.
Okay.
And then writing, that was the other part of your question. I actually, during the tour, and I've never done this except once with the song Take This Chance, I never wrote songs on the road. It never was something I just either write the minute I was starting my album. Like, it was just something I always did. And I already had a tour, and Sony wanted to put this project out, but I felt like I wanted to at least write one song, you know, like one new song to share with my fans, one new reflection from my spirit. And so I wrote Take This Chance. So now on the Ultimate Collection tour, I'm going to try to write more songs and see what comes while I'm working, because it's a different energy when you're working and then you have to create, you know. I don't know if I'll come up with any ideas, you know. I could be like, oh. But I'm going to try and write, and the fans will like that, because they'll wonder, I wonder which day she wrote that. You know, it's just keep them always part of the experience.
Okay. Okay. You have such a strong voice, honestly, full of personality. Who do you think is proving the same among the new generations?
Wow, there's a lot of amazing voices out there. The first one that comes to mind is Amy Winehouse. She was my most favorite voice I've heard in a really long time. I love Kelly Clarkson's voice. I love Adele's voice. So it's the unique voices that I always, my ear is happy to hear. Like I still love to listen to Annie Lennox and her quality in her voice. Lisa Stansfield, I used to love listening to her music, not as much on the radio anymore, but still, I still listen to her music, just not on the radio.
You're one of the fewest white female performers, widely accepted and praised by the black music community. Why do you think it happens?
You know, that was always something that it kind of confused me at the beginning of my early stages of life before I got a career and I was struggling in my 20s, how the black community called me the honorary sister. I was like I was technically a white girl, but I was black inside. I was like, what? I never really understood that technically, but I rolled with it, but once I watched myself for the first time on video, which was at the beginning of my career, like at 30, I think it was the first time, 29, 30, when I saw myself actually sing, I kind of understood what they meant. Like, what? How does that come? That's so weird. That's why. It makes you just go, where did all of that soul, that passion, that thing that usually happens in the church singers or the soulful gospel singers, and I don't know where any of that necessarily comes from, because I'm super Caucasian Asia. Like, I'm there is no other. I'm so white girl. But when I sing, there's a passion that comes out of me that just is from a different spirit, I think.
Please stop quite talking now. Okay. What are your music roots from the very beginning, and who are the major artists that inspired you back then?
Well, I know that this would never, if somebody tried to guess, they would be like, no, they would never guess. So to me, the records that were in our house were every Barbra Streisand record, like nonstop, every Elton John record, the album to the musical Hair. I listened to that like all the time. I would do all of the characters, like every, like Aquarius, everything. I'd put nylon on my head to make your beautiful hair that you have. I would create my own really long hair with a pair of nylons and have the long hair. My sister and I would be in the living room being like, Aquarius. Yeah. So I have to say, I don't really know. It probably a combination of that, weirdly enough, if you think about it, it could make sense. Barbra Streisand was very comical in her delivery of her music, but also very technical and strong voice. And Elton was this flamboyant, amazing guy who wore amazing glasses that I think he's my father. But he'd be my mother father. He'd be my, I don't know what he'd be. But I just think that those are my musical memoirs, and then my mother and my father, who my father was a crooner and my mother was Broadway musical. And when my mother would listen to my new music or music that I would do at the first when I try to write, she'd be like, your phrasing, it's not on point. So because she's from theater, so I breathe in the wrong place and sort of, I say, there, I don't say there, and she'd be like, what is wrong with you? Why don't you have, what's wrong with your talking? So that's my musical influences to me. It's not very typical
Wow.
though.
Okay. Just a second. Oh, just a second. Okay. Is there a particular artist you fell in love with?
There are so many artists that I have a girl crush on Rihanna. I have to keep it real. In my private life, I think I'm Rihanna, but I have no clue. I so can't be cool enough to be her. And I love the Black Keys. My musical variety is so I love talent. I love people that just emulate their own individuality in music. And it can be from, I love Macklemore. If I was a rapper, I would so want to be Macklemore. I would so be like, I love his humor and his intelligence. And just the mixture of the two just makes rapping make sense to me. I've actually had one rapper, P.O.D., on my music. So I can relate to one rapper, but I've never really had those kind of rappers. I've had those kind of rappers.
Okay. Would you advise to whoever would like to begin a musical career nowadays?
I have to say that if I had to give advice to musical people today, I would have no idea how to give advice, because I think today is so much more internet and it's different savvy. And I am not good with technical stuff. I'm learning. My fans are so cute with me. They just know I'm not like I'm just techie stages. Finally, I get on Periscope and they're like, oh my God, it's like, that's so yesterday. And it's just a beautiful thing to watch the world become a different world musically, but it's not something I could give advice to the new audience, because they do all of this stuff with their voice and they do stuff I don't do, so I can't help them out. I just do my thing. I sing in a microphone and that's it. So I have no clue what to do today's world. I think they wouldn't ask me.
Okay. So moving on. Music has been changing a lot lately, and also the way of selling and listening music have drastically changed because of technology.
Yes.
What do you think would be the future? What is your attitude towards technology, music, and the digital era?
I love the music of the future. I love the digital world. I feel sorry for music losing its value. I think it's lost its value forever. It will always, unless somebody creates something that is the new way of getting your music and allowing it to be purchased. But right now, music is free, technically. People respect it and they appreciate it and they will buy it, and they become more aware that we can't stay alive musically unless we try to get people to buy our music. But I think that is what music is moving into, is you have to give it for free first, get people to like you. Then if they see your performance, then you can become an artist these days. I think that's just going to be the reality of what music is. And that's a shame, because we haven't given people the ability to be the artists they become. U2 said once, or many times I'm sure, but I heard once they said that if they only had one record to work out being U2, they would never be here today. Their record company stood by them and let them develop and work into an artist. And these days it's just, they don't have the money or the ability. And I understand that. as record companies and artists to do what they used to do and work an artist those ways. So I have no idea what music's going to turn into. I'm grateful to be part of the olden days of when we actually had vinyl on, you know, and I still call it a record.
Okay. This is also the era of TV talent shows. From your point of view, being an artist, is it easier or more difficult to succeed with your own talent and personality compared to, let's say, 10, 15 years ago?
I think it's very difficult to be an artist these days without having some kind of reality-based situation and a TV show to spring off of, or of a YouTube video that goes viral. It's not a world that is gradual. It's immediate and it's all or nothing. And that's a big amount to swallow as a new artist. That's a lot to take in. And I feel for the new artists these days because it feels like it's a lot to me. Yet they love it and they still want to do it. And you still see so many people coming out every day with music, and internet is buzzing all the time. So it doesn't inhibit people. I think everyone feels they have a chance is more what, where music has gone, is that everybody's a singer. You know, it's just whether or not you get the opportunity to go viral, you know. But I don't think everyone's a singer, technically. I know they're not. You're not. You're just not, because I told you so. I know, I'm sorry. I know, I don't stay very serious very long. I know, I'm having a humorous conversation with myself. And everybody's like, sorry.
I'm just trying not to laugh.
I know, it's an awful thing I do to you.
You've written and recorded an album such as It's a Man's World with many strong lyrics and themes. Is there a musical area that you've never really tried so far and you would be interested in exploring in the future?
Wow, that's a great question. I think I'll just have to find, I'd have to find out by testing different musical areas out if there is a new genre for me. But so far, I feel very, very comfortable in my lane. Like where I'm at, I don't feel I need to explored, like I would never take on the opera, you know. I mean, my closest thing to opera was the beginning of Left Outside Alone. That's like, rawr, that's where, and I'm barely even getting that out half the time during the concert because I'm, it's like, it's like, ooh, you have to go so slow and so immediately into that, and I'm like, rawr, 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 and Left Outside, it's very difficult personalities. Maybe there is something I would, if an artist would approach me, you just never know if it would work. But I try to stay pretty sprock oriented, soul pop rock chick that I feel I am.
Okay. So last question. Is there a phrase from a book or a movie that you consider that somehow changed your life?
You're coming with some doozies right now, yo. I'm like, ah, my God, I don't know if I can talk to you forever. No, I don't know. You're gonna make me want to think about it and then call you and tell you. This is it. Like, so ask me another question. I don't have an answer for you. That was an awesome freaking question, though.
Another weird one. If you could possibly travel back in time, in which era would you want to find yourself for an hour of your life?
An hour. Oh my goodness. An hour in an era. Let's see. Um, part of my heart, like at first I was like, oh my God, 50s would be awesome. And then I was like, no, we didn't vote. And then all of a sudden I went, oh, 70s would be great because then I could do drugs and I'm not into drugs, but I would be like, at least I would know what it would be like to be on all those drugs because my mom says it was awesome. And I don't know, I think I was supposed to be to like now is my time because I'm supposed to teach people to live in today. And that's who I am. I live in the moment. I like to, but I'm spontaneous at the same time. It's, you don't need to overthink it. So I don't think there, a decade can't handle me, man. No decade can handle me. That's what's up. Okay. Thank you.
Thank
I
you.
appreciate it.
Thank you.